Hi everyone, and welcome to your horoscope for the week of November the 8th, 2021. We have a really active and again very intense sky playing out all throughout the week, and this is where, you know, the tension, the intensity of all is definitely going to get stronger. And this perhaps isn't the most fantastic news on a 3D level, but this energy does serve a very important purpose, especially around this time in Scorpio season. Both individually and collectively, there are certain truths that we have to be aware of. And as I said, this is perfectly valid, collectively speaking, where, you know, this energy just invites us through a lot of triggers. Because Mars is in its home sign of Scorpio, and I'll speak about this in greater detail later on, but one of the expressions of this Mars is trigger. Many things that might take place, especially on the world stage, because we're talking about collectively right now, well, they're going to remind us of a fear, of a frustration. They might immediately, instantly take away a, let's say, a hope of ours, an idealistic worldview, an optimism, if that makes sense. So it will be a kind of harsh reality check through our triggers, of course. But this energy isn't really serving the purpose to, you know, demoralize us or to send us into panic or fear, but quite the contrary, to bring to our awareness certain issues, certain truths being revealed, secrets being revealed, basically a reflection of reality that basically is part of our everyday lives, just that for either external reasons or our own personal choices, we might find it very hard to look at those things. For example, one of the big truths, so to speak, coming out is going to be about a political corruption, the corruption within the government and every big corporation, the World Bank, the world economy, the energetic crisis as well, because Scorpio does have an expression, a physical expression of fuel and energy being burned up. The ruler of Scorpio is Pluto in the sign of Capricorn. That is all about, like, fossil fuel and everything that basically fuels the motor of our existence and life, both symbolically, like money, or physically, like, for example, food. The energy that goes into our equipment, heater, etc. So, in the very earthly and disciplined sign of Capricorn, well, it is also about the value, about the price, the sacrifice we have to basically enable in our lives to have the fuel, to have the resources, to have what to burn, and the fair, equal repartition of this, which doesn't depend on us, of course. And very many times, certain blockages in our lives are not due to us and our choices. Most of the times, of course, they are. But we must also take a look at all those things which genuinely don't depend on us. And no matter how truthful we want to be with ourselves, there is no interior truth to look at when something is genuinely blocking you, but it's not your fault, not in your power, it is just something, the setup basically. For example, a law or legislation which is very unfair or is not built very well, that has nothing to do with your personal choices or anything about you really, and it can still block you. So from a collective perspective, these are the issues and triggers that are going to be very, very activated. These hard to look at truths that might block us, influence us negatively, take away our power, take away our liberty, so to speak. and they're not really our own fabrications, of the result of our own work and choices. And this is exactly why it's so hard to look at these things collectively, because what power do we have over these on one hand? And if we want to have more power over these, what it is that we have to do? And one of the choices is Mars, to fight for it. How, in which manner, in what modus operandi, that's another question. So that is why the truth that is being revealed right now is so uncomfortable to look at, especially collectively, because, you know, this is also not just the kind of truth that pops up unexpectedly, but this is also scorpionic energy, investigation, digging deep, the profundity, the intensity, the severity of it all. And Scorpio also rules secrets and everything that is hidden beyond the shadow. So you can imagine that it's gonna bring forth some very delicate, some very, you know, controversial subjects and themes and even investigations and opinions. So we can already see how this is going to be a massive trigger. And to add to this energy, this is just the fuse. This is just the trigger, so to speak. We also have the Eris-Pluto square, which I have been emphasizing upon in so very many different recordings. The fight for freedom, the fight for sovereignty, everyone's individual fight to have their voices heard, that they count, they exist, for the sheer fact that they take breath, they breathe, you know, Aries, the first breath, that automatically entitles everyone to certain rights, human rights. So this energy is not going anywhere. This energy is extremely precise and active right now. So this translates to protests, to people fighting for their rights, and we're already seeing this play out on the world stage. This energy is nothing new. Even when Eris in the sign of Aries and Pluto are not exact in this conversation of tension, because they're so slow-moving planets, they're still only 1 or 2 degrees apart from perfecting the square. And this has been pretty much the same for the past 2 years. And this square will definitely follow us and guide us, if that makes sense, all throughout 2022. So it's not going anywhere. It will only, like, break up for real in a very noticeable way around 2024 as Pluto leaves the sign of Capricorn. But this is just one part of the story. The other one is the signature aspect of 2021. The Saturn and Uranus square is coming back online. So this is where the pressure is truly on. And from a collective perspective, this continues the theme: fight for freedom, fight for equality, fight for humanitarianism, fight for righteousness, and ultimately the truth of all of this, Uranus. And on another hand, it's the energy of out with the old and in with the new. We need to upgrade, we need to improvise, we need to basically project authenticity onto every single area of life. This is basically the energy of a very hard, profound reform. The best way to understand the Saturn and Uranus square is like a symbolism, let's say, where you have a tooth, and the tooth symbol is very precise because Saturn does rule teeth. So you have a tooth and it's decaying, it has cavities, and it's starting to hurt, so you go to the dentist. Going to the dentist symbolically already took place. That was the very, very intense Pluto-Saturn conjunction on the 12th of January 2020. Pluto is the dentist, Pluto is the doctor, Pluto is who digs drills very, very deep to get rid of the cavity, to get rid of the bad part of the tooth. So we already had that. Problem is, we didn't have too much anesthetic to numb the pain, but that's a totally different question. So basically, the dentist tells you that the cavity, the problem goes very, very deep, straight to the root of the tooth. So it's already a root canal. And that is not easy. Even when the anesthetic works, there's still the psychological element of tension that someone's drilling in your mouth for maybe an hour now, and when is it going to be over? And the needles and all that stuff, so it's not a pretty sight. So basically, we are collectively, as a species, at around the final stages of this drilling and the root canal being executed, being done, being completed, so to speak. But we're not out of the woods just yet, because on one hand, the dentist Pluto, the scorpionic energy, has to put the filling and everything into the root and close it, and then put medicine there so any infection and everything clears. And that part is being done right now. The disinfectant, Scorpio, the finishing touches, so this very strong Plutonian energy, which will get more intense around 2022, 2023, when it activates in the US natal chart, when the United States has their Pluto return perfected to the degree, Pluto perfectly conjunct Pluto, and that will be a massive pivotal moment for everyone, because whatever happens in the US will basically mirror and echo worldwide. And then we get to the part later on when the dentist has to reconstruct the tooth, turn it back into what it was, a tooth. So that is still work in progress. But ultimately, that is the easy part. You don't even need an anesthetic for that. So this year 2022 is going to be like the disinfectant period, if the tooth is basically the old order, the old paradigm. And the Neptune-Jupiter conjunction next year in the spring, well, that is going to be a big disinfecting moment, because both of these planets have a lot to do with dissolving the past, dissolving the problem, dissolving the pain, disinfecting, so to speak, karmically. And that means that they do have to wash away a lot of hurt and also bring forward forgiveness, release. And going back to my original metaphor, in this stage, we do have to follow the instructions of the dentist to the letter, because if that root canal gets infected and there's pus building up, well, chances are we are gonna lose the tooth. The reconstruction won't take place, or it will take place in more painful ways, like the implant and stuff like that. So this is where we also need to contribute to next year's Jupiter-Neptune conjunction in the sign of Pisces, in the sense that we really have to be very serious, focus on our healings, forgive what we can forgive, process and surrender the rest. And this also means allowing us to truthfully embrace the pain, to look at the extent of the pain, the extent of the trauma, sweeping things under the rug, or just tricking yourself into, it's not as painful, I'm strong enough, good enough. That's all true and fine, but not under that aspect. That aspect requires truth and genuine optimism, which is the desire to heal. And when you genuinely desire to heal, the pain and the painful part of the process, the healing process, is no longer intimidating, because you just want to get it over with, and not necessarily want to delay it. But anyway, I'm so sorry, this is next year's astrology. So going back to the symbolism I used, yes, this Saturn and Uranus square that is coming back online, this is going to be exact for the third and final time on Christmas Eve 2021. That will be a very tensioned moment, of course. Well, we can look at that energy when the root canal is truly complete. But before we get there, so all throughout November and the first half of December, this is where we just have to sit in the dentist chair, again, back to my symbolism, and just bear the final touches until the root canal is finished. And it's not easy, and it's very triggering in the scorpionic season. It is frustrating, it is irritating, both collectively and individually as well. And now getting back finally to this week's energy, well, the truth is going to be part of this week without a shadow of a doubt, because we have the Sun, Mercury and Mars in Scorpio at this time. We also have Venus in the sign of Capricorn, a sign where she is going to spend a lot of time because this is the sign of her retrogradation. But this is also subject of another video. And at the same time, we also have Black Moon Lilith in the sign of Gemini. That means, on one hand, that yes, there is this very powerful detective, investigative, truth-oriented energy of Scorpio. But at the same time, the shadow and all those groups of people who want to hide it, distort it, or use the truth to their advantage, that's also there and very powerful, so it will not come extraordinarily easy. So speaking about the truth, this is also very relevant from a personal, individual perspective, because we have the Mercury and Mars conjunction in the sign of Scorpio, and together they square Saturn, and this is a tough, tough energy. This is all about everything in our lives that we are trying to transform, we are trying to change. We have a lot of clarity and truth, or are in the process of accumulating that, because Mercury is the planet of the mind. In the sign of Scorpio, it wants to look at as objectively, as intensely, as truthfully possible every single detail, every single element. Then there is Mars, the planet of action, that which truly digs deep, that which has the courage, desire, the guts to confront the truth. So we are either digging deep within our own psyche, our memories, our unconscious, or situations in our lives, or it can also be about our most urgent desires, needs, wants that we need to work on, that we need to achieve. And Mercury is the plan, it is the intellectual element where we may have the power, the determination, the willingness, but we also need, on one hand, connections. We might not be able to do this alone. Mercury is connections, after all. Scorpio is that which we share with others. So other people, maybe family, close people, those people who we have any kind of karmic bond with are also part of this picture. Maybe they're part of this picture as in allies or people who we need to get away from. But there is Saturn as well, Saturn in the sign of Aquarius. Everything that prevents us, that makes us feel powerless, or maybe the price, the cost of getting what we want, our desires, is way too high. Because one of the expressions of Mercury and Mars together in Scorpio is also, is it worth it for me? Is it worth my time? Is it worth my sacrifice? Is it worth basically me investing energy into getting where I want, what I want, my desire, etc.? And if the answer is no, yet the want doesn't go anywhere, then we have to tip the balance. We have to make it work for ourselves as well, to be worth it. And that is not easy. That is an energy of frustration, that is an energy of blockage, but the kind of blockage where you want to move that mountain. The mountain does not intimidate you. You just want to muster the will to somehow get it out of the way. And this warrior attitude, this instinctual wanna-do attitude that is specific to Scorpio, is definitely going to be a signature element this week. This is where no matter what that Saturn poses for us individually, it doesn't matter what kind of obstacle it is. For example, our local community, our family, the place where we live, our country, the legislation, other people, or our own insecurities, our own inner limitations, our own principles, ideals, etc. So very many things can be a limit with that Saturn. How do we overcome the limit? And with Saturn in Aquarius, we don't have that many choices. And with Saturn, one choice, regardless of which part of the sky and sign and conversation is in, is always work, hard work, perseverance. But that takes time. Then, if we add the specifics of Aquarius to it, there is help from others. Power of the many. But of course, not everyone has a lot of friends, acquaintances, and support out there. Then there is the other way of Aquarius, intelligence. Saturn does permit in its ancient ruling sign of Aquarius for the limitations and restrictions that it usually poses to be overcome with high intelligence and cunning. And finally, and this is also where the Uranian energy, the modern ruling planet of Aquarius, comes into play, a divine ingenuity. That is when you tap into the most original part of your being and just come up with a crazy yet ingenious futuristic solution. So basically, these are the options we can work with in order to get where we need to be to fulfill that want, that need, that desire. And it's not very easy. And we must also take into consideration that both Mars and Mercury are starting their opposition to Uranus. Mercury's opposition to Uranus is going to be perfect on the 13th of November, so this week, while Mars will perfect it later on. Yet still, whenever these two power players oppose Uranus, that means the unexpected, that means surprise, that means chaos, that means shock, that means the unpredictable, getting into the big picture suddenly, unexpectedly. Now, individually, this isn't as bad because it is basically chaos entering our lives unexpectedly, but that can catapult us a long way to where we want to be, as long as we're resourceful, as long as we have a certain kind of versatility about us. And at the same time, even though it's an opposition, so it's very confusing, it's very hard to process, that can also bring unexpected opportunities, pleasant surprises, and random spur of the moment when you just have this wild inspiration, go do it and achieve success immediately. Of course, there is also an element of contradiction, conflict, angry words, saying very hard truths, sharing secrets or secrets just spilled out. Some of these secrets, especially from an individual perspective, are not going to be very easy. Because this is like either coming out of the closet or skeletons being revealed in the closet. Anyway, we can still turn this to our advantage because this truth always sets us free. It's a game changer, but it's always, always, always for the better. But the opposition with Mars is a little bit different, because Mars is extremely intense in Scorpio, and that can represent unexpected outbursts, like triggers, anger, angry moments, rebellion, revolt. and losing temper, but in a big way. And collectively, it's even more severe than that, because every time when Mars and Uranus oppose, that can mean accidents, explosions, fire, earthquakes, mutation, especially in the pandemic context. That's not the most fortunate energy, if that makes sense, because if you remember, the COVID itself burst out, broke out, started to spread on exactly Mars and Uranus opposition, where Mars and Uranus were in the same part of this, different degrees, but in the same part of the sky in 2019. More specifically, November 2019. So, you know, this means going back to the investigation, what happened with the COVID, how it started, the laboratory, the medical part of it. So that is definitely going to be a big theme. And there are going to be some shocking truths and revelations that might cause conflicts and anger and outbursts, even from international power players. So things are getting tensionate. And on top of this, the risk of earthquakes, natural calamities, explosions, and of course, extremely violent outbursts somewhere. Uranus does like to do that. And Mars, you know, you don't have to invite Mars into a fight twice. It wants to be there. And on top of this, with the Eris-Pluto square, Eris wants it just as badly, if that makes sense. Yet, on top of all this chaos... Oh, and one last thing, sorry. Whenever there is Mars and Uranus opposition, be very careful not to... It's not a good time to go and do extreme sports. Respect health and safety rules, regulations at your work, in your house, when driving, when doing anything with an element of risk attached to it. Be safe. So going back to the Mercury and Mars conjunction, yes, it can be anger, it can be angry birds, conflict, especially that Mars is in a part of the sky known as Via Combusta, the path of combustion. So conflicts are actually part of this picture, angry birds and burst outs, anything of this nature. But there are also opportunities. There is also a good side of this energy, because both of these planets hold a sextile, a harmonious conversation with Venus. So Mars can also be passion, and Mercury can also be knowledge, especially in Scorpio. That can represent passionate communication, conversations, sharing, especially through words, any kind of mercurial expression, way of sharing. It can also be hinting, it can also be nonverbal communication, because Scorpio is also all about that. And there is a very strong magnetism about this. If you communicate, if you project, if you let other people know about what you're passionate about, desires, etc., it can very quickly attract that which you seek, especially if that is a person, someone who you want to collaborate with. It's a really, really good aspect for financial plans, maybe to discuss investments, to ask advice, to create longer-term financial plans. If you are looking for changes, upgrades, rearrangements in your career, or livelihood, or financial situation, this is also a very good energy. It is also, again, good energy for romantic connections, for flirting, for physical attraction. Venus is in the very down-to-earth sign of Capricorn, after all. So that's like Venusian earth energy, physical body, physical attraction, pheromones, even the value of all of it, you know, love expressed physically. And in the sign of Capricorn, it's not just about body. It is about gestures, morality, courtesy, manners. How you treat someone in a loving way. What do your gestures speak about you and the way you love, your value system? So this is the kind of energy when manners and, you know, just being a loving human being can get you a very, very long way. It can make you very, very attractive. And last but not least, this is also the energy of psychological empowerment. Mars in the sign of Scorpio, treasure digger energy, treasure seeker, treasure finder. If it is looking for something, may that treasure be something spiritual, emotional, material. It can find it. It has the steam. It has the drive. It has the instinct. It has the determination. It has the intensity, because all parts of the being, including the unconscious, wants to cooperate when there is a strong desire, when there is that steam inside. And in this sense, the opposition with Uranus can actually be a good thing. Chaos is really, really good for bringing people together, especially people who would not meet usually in usual, foreseeable, comfortable circumstances. The discomfort, the chaos, the turbulence can actually connect people very, very well together. And this part of the picture is also really valid for the longer term Uranus and Saturn square. Because yes, that means a lot of problems, unexpected arising in our lives, individually speaking, of course. But that also means that perhaps in certain situations we will need unusual help, and there's the opportunity to connect to unusual people. And that can create unusual, futuristic, but really functional, if that makes sense, alliances. And before I move on, I would just like to go back to the Mercury and Uranus opposition. This is also good for very many different things. Getting questions to answers to curiosities, clarity, finding out stuff, regardless in which sense, in which area of life, it's definitely good for that. Just that, be aware that when you ask a question, the answer will come in a way to reflect the validity, if that makes sense, of the question. So, you know, when you ask chaos something, prepare for a very intense answer, if that makes sense. This energy is also all about coincidences and synchronicity, because Uranus is the higher octave of Mercury. Mercury is the lower mind, our usual cognitive features, if that makes sense, while Uranus is the higher mind. And when these two planets oppose each other, they want to understand each other. They actually want to build a bridge. But that means balance. But balance can only be created if we behold the truth in a very unapologetic way. So this means that we have to prepare for unexpected communication, unexpected connections, people sharing things with us in such a way where it does leave some kind of impact. And even though this can, of course, lead to misunderstanding and miscommunication, but at the same time, it can also lead to really powerful, sudden realizations, moments of truth, us being able to understand our wounds, our repressed emotions, our triggers, that much more clearly by witnessing those of others. This is also about our value systems, our self-worth, what we hold valuable in our lives, regardless of which nature, because Uranus is in the Earth sign of Taurus. And it might actually surprise us. We might surprise ourselves. We might find out, surprisingly, of course, with Uranus, that many things that we held valuable and we emphasized on value-wise before this powerful and massive world change Well, those are no longer truly loved by us anymore. Sometimes the fact that we have underwent a profound transformation, change and rearrangement, you know, it's not very visible to us because we can't see ourselves as outsiders, especially with matters of love and everything that we like, everything that basically have us emotionally respond. So we do need triggers to reflect that to us. Like, let me just give you an example. Maybe you used to love certain foods before the pandemic. Let's say fast foods because they were quick, easy and tasty. And because of what happened in your life and how you coped with lockdowns and restrictions, your something inside of you, let's say, maybe your instinctual intelligence, basically the natural intelligence of your body, has changed and you don't no longer crave fast food. Something that you used to love almost instinctually is now something you don't love anymore. And this already is a reflection of how something inside of you, your value system, has already changed and transformed, and you're a little bit, just a tiny little bit, someone else. Not that someone who used to be in 2020. But of course, this will be the main theme of this Venus retrograde season, so you'll hear more about this later on. So, as I said, there is a lot of tension and energy in the sky, but there's also one of supreme harmony, where the Sun in the sign of Scorpio holds a trine with Venus in the sign of Pisces. And this is really, really powerful because Neptune himself is in the Scorpionic decan of Pisces. So this is a highly Scorpionic, transformative energy. And because it's a trine, it's healing. It is inspirational. It is alchemical. It is deeply rooted in faith, in pure faith and trust in the mystery and benevolence of the universe. This is one of the coping mechanisms to all the triggers, tension, frustration, anger, not being able to get what we want, everything that I have spoken about before. Because, you know, there is this reality check, the Saturnian, Saturn square, Mercury and Mars in the sky. We cannot do this, that and that because of facts, figures, numbers, as in let's be real. But there is this mysterious, super concentrated, misty, miraculous, psychological, spiritual energy in the background enveloping us. And also encompassing us from the inside. So it's not just a feeling we have that we pick up, you know, from external reality. But it is also very much alive within us. You know, perhaps in our dreams, in our altered states of consciousness, spiritual work, the time that we spend with ourselves, our sacred solitude moments. There is a strong, mysterious force of pure faith, the source, the spirit, all around us and within us. And it's whispering to us in a very subtle way that anything is truly possible if you believe with every fiber of your being. And this is also where the shadow becomes an ally, a benefactor, a friend, and not an enemy. Because it can give us all the motives, all the reasons to believe. It can kind of justify every single excuse, let's say, why we would want to bring up of why we should not live that, why we shouldn't get what we want, why dreams should not become reality, and stuff like that. And very many times, the shadow acting this way is basically a trick because we're trying to justify stuff to ourselves. But when it's like an alchemical formula and you really need to believe that with every fiber of your being, well, in those moments, this is exactly what we need. That we can do it, we can accomplish it, we can live it. We have enough magic in our beings to make it happen. The divine is more superior, powerful, call it whatever you want, than any other force in external reality, or that which created all. The good, the bad, the dense, the light, all. Can ultimately create that which we desire, even if it might be improbable in on a 3D level, let's say. So basically, this is the energy of deep, profound, and pure faith. Purity is a big requirement here. And this aspect is also one of compassion, empathy, solidarity. Sometimes it's not just compassion, solidarity, and true unconditional love for another. It is also towards ourselves. Some people find it so hard to act this way, to be this way towards themselves. They find it very easy to do this for others. So this is where the sky gives you the power to be this way for yourself. And that alone, it is a really powerful, healing, regenerative energy. Needless to say that it's profoundly artistic. I would not be surprised if an artist out there would have a big breakthrough moment, like a big hit, something really beautiful and catchy, like a song or something like that, coming out next week. And if you're an artist of any kind, regardless of what it is that you do, this can also be perfectly well your moment. This is also a big blessing for everyone with spiritual activities, everyone who's into magic, the occult, astrology, even psychology, parapsychology, even, you know, mythology and ancient civilization. At this time, whenever Neptune holds this type of conversation with the Sun in Scorpio, we tend to see big archaeological discoveries about the distant past and stuff like that. So this is truly the blessing of the presence of the spirit, not just within us, but basically all around us. This is one of those energies which are beneficial in a very profoundly fated and karmic way. So this is definitely good. And this is definitely a really good cure for frustrations, triggers, anger, conflicts, all of the negative expressions of the Scorpionic energy. And we also have another beautiful celestial conversation, which will get more active towards the very, very end of the week. Venus trining Uranus. This is the energy of good luck. This is a truly fortunate energy, materially, job-wise, career-wise, life path-wise, romantically, of course, even artistically. Venus is the lower benefic, so she is associated with good fortune, good luck, all the good things, the pleasurable, the joyful things. Uranus in Venus's home sign of Taurus can be a pleasant surprise, a pleasant intervention, a compliment, reputation, like the most delightful aspect of chaos, the pleasant surprises. This can also be a very good energy professionally, you know, promotions at work, an unexpected opportunity, or perhaps maybe not so very unexpected, the opportunity itself, but it being offered to you in a very, let's say, honorable and complementary way, shape, and form is going to be the surprise element. So this is really good for professional advancements in your career, new position, a higher position, reward, gratitude, financially even for your work, a new job opportunity. If you're like a highly skilled professional, a freelancer, have your own business project type work. This is like being connected to the best possible either clients or opportunities, lucratively speaking, anything that has to do with spontaneous connections. You know, this is also a good energy for receiving presents, receiving recognition, honors, gratitude, etc. This energy is also when someone just catapults themselves or is catapulted by fated forces into the spotlight. Someone previously anonymous becoming very notorious in a second, in an instant, in a flash. You know, this is like the X Factor type of energy where this unknown person enters the stage and just bombards everyone with insane talent, and people ask themselves, where were you all my life? This is that kind of energy where there are rewards and big honors and big pleasant surprises in store for some very fortunate people. But of course, there is another element to this where the sun holds the square with Jupiter. Jupiter is the planet of expansion. Jupiter is planet of excess. So, you know, regardless of what beautiful surprises come our way, we must make sure to have enough discipline not to have this spoil our experience with excess by giving into excess. And another not so favorable expression of this energy, well, it can represent profound resentment, as in, let's say, something truly wonderful happens to you and you deserve it and you worked for it. You know, it is your moment when the universe just gives you that which is yours, let's just say, regardless of what shape and form that takes. But because you have so much pain inside of you, because you suffered a lot, let's say, in the past, you cannot accept the honor, the gratitude, the appreciation, regardless of which way and way, shape and form it comes into your life. You will just be so sorrowful that you just say, you know, I only did this to prove to myself that I can do it. Bye. Not a smile, not anything, quite the opposite. The bitterness is very, very much alive inside of us. We must make sure that we don't allow one of these moments to take place in our lives, regardless of how strong resentments and sorrows and pain we have inside, because if we do this, we just hurt ourselves. We just sever our connection with the universe. Because by a gesture like this, when we just walk away from a moment of triumph, a moment of glory, a moment of pleasure, a moment of honor, then we just walk away from our own sacrifice. We just symbolically, and sorry for this bad choice of words, we spit ourselves in the face, and it won't get us anywhere. It is just the shadow wanting to hurt back. Maybe fate herself, maybe the universe, as we were hurt at a certain moment in our lives. But that's all it is. The sorrow loser, basically, and we must not become that person. And also with the sun being in the sign of Scorpio, with squaring Jupiter, we also have to be careful on one hand not to think that any kind of escapism will solve our problems and will truly make the pain less painful. Because, you know, with Jupiter we can overdo it, and it's dangerous. In this November, in this period, overdoing escapism, especially if it's substance, alcohol or whatever, even if it's just fantasy, even if it's just, let's say, I don't know, computer game or fantasy novels, whatever, it's dangerous. We need to have one foot in physical reality at this time. And another negative expression of this energy is self-indulgence. We have to be careful. We have to have limits. We have, as I said, one foot in physical reality, and that means we can not allow ourselves to indulge if that indulgement is dumbing us. And last but not least, the Venus and Uranus trine and I would like to focus on this a little bit, even though this conversation happens every year, so it's not the rarest of energies, yet still it's a spark of inspiration, it's a spark of joy, it's a spark of pleasure to help us elevate the Scorpionic mood this week, so it is kind of important, especially that Venus in the sign of Taurus is all about felt and earthly expressed pleasure, so it's not just philosophy. And this energy can be really, really good for love and romance. So, you know, regardless of how hard this week can be from a psychological perspective, self-discipline perspective, and even mental perspective, because, as I said, truth and information, communication, objective reality and everything like that, well, it's all good and positive, but it can really overdrive our brain, our mental sphere. It can be very, very much this week. So maybe this opportunity of love and pleasure and something beautiful happening to us, a pleasant surprise, is just what we need, not to stay immersed and to drown in the heavier stuff. So if someone asks you out on a date, surprisingly, unexpectedly, someone offers you beautiful compliments, appreciation, something really lovely, nice, or a present, or anything Venusian of nature, in that moment, just stop everything that you're doing, contemplating, processing, thinking about, and immerse into the gesture, into the pleasure, into the beautiful surprise, and just live it through. Don't spoil it for yourself by allowing your thoughts to still work with the Scorpionic theme in the background. Just whenever Venus offers you something beautiful, stop right there, accept and embrace it. So this concludes the horoscope for next week. Thank you so much for being here. Thank you so much for listening. And please remember, as triggering, irritating, frustrating, hard this energy may be, we must not forget about Neptune, about our spirituality, our divine source, our genuine connection to spirit, being plugged into source, because that can be the biggest saving grace now. That can make all the difference. That can turn the frustration into a healing experience. So you're never alone, truly. You're not abandoned. You're not going through whatever purges this Scorpio season has for you alone. The divine mystery itself is all around us, all around all of our gestures, everything synchronistic that happens to us. And ultimately, it's that much more alive inside us, in our unconscious. And perhaps this is the biggest blessing that is being offered to us at this time. And we are truly lucky, because not every generation out there can live Neptune being in its home sign of Pisces, and being also in the third decan of Pisces, the most profound one. So all of us alive today, every single one of us right now, has this, which isn't even once in a lifetime opportunity, it's even rarer than that, to tap into profound healing, Neptune in the third decan of its home sign, Pisces, not just to heal our own wounds, regardless of how hard it may have been for us, regardless of whatever might have happened in our distant past, because basically that's Pisces. But we also have this opportunity to be a force of healing for everyone out there unconditionally, even from a non-very earthly perspective, because this healing that we are experiencing right now, the purges and all of that, it is also healing the past of our race, of our species. We're healing with this energy past collective traumas, pains, and big problems that our species has faced, and it left a big imprint on us. So we are truly making the world a better place for the future generations, karmically speaking, and that is a big, big thing that we're doing. And perhaps that is why, in certain moments, life is simply impossible to just process in a very basic human way. That is why, for so very many truly spirited people out there, certain usual small things in life, like a very small advancement in career, prosperity, money, housing, where to stay, the basic needs, you know, this is like the core basic needs are not even being met. And this isn't like bad karma, although so many of us are totally swept away by despair of why me. This is actually happening to you because you are one of those people who is capable to manifest the spirit in physical reality. And basically, this Neptune will not leave you alone until one way or another, depending on how you cooperate with it, have no choice but to somehow manifest that which life makes impossible for you. It's so easy for other people and it's impossible for you, but that is exactly the reason why, because you can do it your way by working with the spirit. And by no means am I encouraging anyone to get into those manifestation workshops or courses or whatever, because that is definitely the wrong way to do it. That will never ever work for you personally, and you probably might have tried it 10 million times and no results. Because the key to your success is Neptune, so it means purity. To desire it so purely, so innocently, so lovingly, that reality itself cracks and gives you what you wanted. Because of the purity, not because of the willpower, not because of the self-manipulation that I'm worth it, I'm so good, whatever, no. Not because of any kind of unconscious methodology, not because of compensation to what you've been through in your life, just because of that purity, because that is the divine spark within us. Of course, all the other methods mentioned that don't work for you work for normal people, but it goes just as soon as the manifestation came in their lives. So that's the big difference here. You are meant to embody the spirit and pull it from the ether into the earthly plane. And the alchemical secret ingredient to that is purity. So that's why everything that is going on seems so extreme. That's why that big success moment is eluding you, because this is what Neptune in the third decan of Pisces attempts to do. Purify everything to its most divine core. Basically, the Christ consciousness, it activates that, and when that is online, you know, worry and insecurity and everything that has been part of your life before stops, and life becomes a different dimension, if that makes sense. So thank you again for listening. If you'd like to support my work, you can leave a donation in the PayPal link in the description below. Thank you again for being here. Wish everyone a magical week. Until next time, bye for now.